Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner. She is a mixed martial artist standing 5'8" tall. Weighing in at the featherweight limit, 146 pounds in one bout. She has one victory, no defeats. Fighting out of West Hollywood, California, here is Baby Hulk, Madison McElhane. And across the cage stands her opponent, fighting out of the red corner. Also a mixed martial artist, she stands 5'6" tall. She too weighed in officially 146 pounds and has one victory and no defeats. She fights out of Orlando, Florida. Here is Felicia Phenom Spencer. And your referee in charge of the action is Mike England.
Mike England getting this assignment. It is Madison McElhaney and Felicia Spencer. TJ DeSantis, Julie Kedzie, Scottish Rite Temple, Kansas City, Missouri, Invicta FC 22. These featherweights fighting early here.
Goodness, big rattle, punching combination there right from McElhaney. A big kick from Felicia. You can see that head kick that she attempted right there. Landed a really nice right hand.
And they have rocked McElhaney now. Spencer able to get the clinch. This is her world. Will she try to take it to the floor or strike? Now she has to battle off the cage.
You know, some of the footage from McElhaney that she's removing online, she does show some very nice clinching skills in some of her early amateur fights.
Felicia Spencer really employed that ground and pound style against Rachel Wiley, as you mentioned. But getting on the inside is going to be a bit of trouble with someone like Madison McElhaney. So when you get these opportunities, you want to make it count.
You do, and you can see how McElhaney has turned her back into the cage. But Felicia Spencer, off of the cage, delivered a very nice knee to the gut.
Now back at space, again into the clinch. Right hand misses there for McElhaney. Shannon Sin weighing in on Twitter. We invite you to do so as well, at TJ DeSantis, at JulesK_fighter, at Invicta Fights. Use that hashtag InvictaFC22.
I'm really liking the kicking of Felicia Spencer right now. Not every head kick has landed, but that front kick to the gut landed just there too. Very nicely done with her kicks and her knees so far.
Big knee there off the break. Don't know how hard it landed. McElhaney still game.
McElhaney's throwing some power too with those shots. You know, she was rattling off some very, very fast punching combinations earlier.
Trip attempt there by Spencer. McElhaney punches out of it.
Wow, right hand to a beautiful kick to the body. Both of these women are showing no trepidation when it comes to power shots here.
Yeah, they are definitely here to fight, and that is setting a nice bar here for our first contest of the evening, Invicta FC 22 here in Kansas City.
And look at the way Felicia Spencer's based her hand off and threw that elbow. Oh, beautiful toss.
Nicely done. It looked like McElhaney had double unders there for a moment, but Spencer didn't care and dunked her on her head.
And this is where Spencer was very successful in her Invicta Fights debut with her ground and pound from this position. Looks like she wants to maintain top position and hit. McElhaney is rolling over into a position to isolate an arm there, but she's giving up her back.
Nice knees to the body there for Spencer on the body of McElhaney. Now we see McElhaney standing. Not a grounded opponent here. She could knee to the head, and she does.
Nicely done there. Good read on that position.
Touch under 2.5 minutes here. Left here in round number one.
And McElhaney's definitely keeping her composure right here. You know, she's back on her feet. She's splitting her guard, so it's harder to take her down. You can see there's definitely a takedown attempt there from Felicia, trying to split through and trip her with her right hand. Nice knee.
Some blood coming from the nose of Madison McElhaney. Definitely uncomfortable here against the fence. This has been a very fast, quick pace early, 3 minutes into this bout. We'll see how long they can keep this pace up.
Yeah, we're seeing this high crotch to almost trip attempt there from Felicia Spencer. She's got that nice underhook, and again, she's trying to toss her over. What McElhaney needs to do is free her head, which she does.
Nice elbow there by Spencer. McElhaney trying to get off the fence. Oh, beautiful time.
Nice.
McElhaney with a throw of her own.
She read that forward aggressive pressure, and Spencer's head position was able to toss her over her hips.
She's on top here with 90 seconds remaining in the first round. See if she can take some of this round back. Spencer trying to get her guard, and she does.
can see Spencer climbing her legs up, trying to get to a higher guard position. Underhooking the leg right there is kind of ill-advised, in my opinion, because it can open her up to strikes on that side. She lets go of that underhook, and now she's breaking the posture of McElhane, pulling her head down so she can't deliver as effective, or excuse me, as strong of a strike from that position.
Spencer's been on the floor here for now about 30 seconds, and she's been controlling the pace, landing elbows, trying to angle off to the side. This is how a fighter can win a round.
Look at the arm position of McElhane right there. Spencer was trying to read that. She actually uses that to roll her over. Beautiful attempt at an armbar roll. Unfortunately, McElhane's arms are almost completely freed right there. She's not in really danger of getting armbarred just yet, but she could be, and she's out.
Now McElhane given a nice position here with less than 30 seconds remaining. We'll see if she can control her, but it's Spencer that is getting a little bit unorthodox with her approach and has yet to pay for it, but McElhane looked like she's trying to attack the neck, but she's gonna end up on her back.
Yeah, that's a nice read by McElhane.
Oh, wow.
Nice roll through with that, with the gator roll. She's got her locked in the head and arm. Not sure how tightly that cinched her on her neck.
5 minutes in the books. Really nice, fun back and forth fights, and we'll see how the ladies adjust in between rounds. Tactical strategies need to be adjusted, but you know, both have their moments.
Not enough time in the round, not the perfect position for that choke, but a very good attempt and possibly a moral victory in her head at the end of the round.
Both featherweights showing their skills, and one thing to key in on, Julie, these ladies are both natural featherweights, 35 not an option, but right now, McElhane putting it on Spencer. Spencer firing back.
And you know, those kicks that I mentioned of Spencer's, they're very nice, but if you throw an unsupported or an unguarded kick like that, it does, ooh, beautiful. there's an unguarded kick. It does put you at a disadvantage for open shots. Your head is in a position to be hit right there.
Spencer telegraphed that spin kick a little bit too much, but just throwing it out there has got to make McElhane think.
Yes, absolutely. And McElhane, you know, again, that right hand has been landing pretty consistently for her.
Take the lead leg of McElhane by Spencer, now back into the clinch.
And right here, this is where both of these fighters have successfully tossed the other onto their back, reading the hips, reading the head positioning. You know, it's been, ooh, nice foot stomps there. It's been successful for both of them. I'm not sure that's necessarily the best throw to be going for, but it's hard to argue with a successful throw.
Dirty boxing here, up against the fence for Spencer, McElhane being defensive. We'll see if she can get underhooks and circle off the cage.
And Spencer's doing beautiful work with her head right there, getting it into position. You know, even when your back is against the cage, you can get your head in the right spot, your balance is maintained. Nice lead elbow.
The standing elbows here have been in the body. It's hard.
Beautiful.
Left high kick by Spencer. Knee to the body, right hand. McElhane backing up now. Back in the clinch, big knee up coming again by Spencer.
Spencer is fighting from every position, and she's actually able to fire that front leg roundhouse kick off beautifully, not telegraphing that very well at all. Now, again, now it's grabbed with a return cross. You have to watch that sometimes. You have to watch that. Putting punches in front of kicks is always advisable.
The forward movement of McElhane has slowed a little bit. Now she's coming back with more punches.
Yeah, it looks like McElhane is trying to find a home for that right hand. It's been very successful in this fight. She has been getting clocked a couple times with those kicks, but she really wants that right hand to land. And, you know, with good reason. It's a hard shot.
Punch is still there for McElhane. A lot of power on them. They're not as crisp and fast as they were before, but still powerful, as is that kick from Spencer. Didn't land all that flush, but McElhane now comes up against the fence.
You can see right here, it's a positioning for that underhook. Spencer is really about grabbing onto that head, and normally I would say grabbing around that is difficult. However, she's using that to coax a knee, to coax the positioning of McElhane so that her head is down for a knee. You see a little hematoma. It's a hematoma again coming from one of Felicia Spencer, one of Felicia Spencer's opponents. McElhane is defending well here.
That's a testament to Felicia Spencer's power. We saw it on the floor tonight. We see it on the feet. She really wants to be a factor here at 145 pounds, but dealing with McElhane, who tried to get a trip takedown, and Spencer had none of it, now on top in half.
And you know what I'm impressed about so much right now is the pace of these two fighters right now, TJ. Both of them have continued to fight the entire time, never relenting, always trying to improve position. We can see Felicia Spencer trying to move into mount here on top of McElhane. McElhane is trying to be on an edge, to be on her ribs so that she's not completely flattened out onto the ground.
We'll see if Spencer wants to take that mount. We'll call it maybe a quarter guard here. Some fighters don't actually like the mount because they get rolled off a bit easier.
They can. It's a great position to deliver some super hard ground and pound, but you have to almost work ground and pound to position, ground and pound to position. We're actually seeing that a little bit with Felicia Spencer. But look, she's isolating that arm right now. It looks like she might try for a roll-off armbar.
But she has it. This one extended. McElhane trying to get free, stepping over the body. It looks like she's going to get away from this, Julie, if Spencer can't readjust.
I can't see the position of her elbow, but it looks like she's defending it pretty well there. Now, looks like Spencer might be trying to roll into a triangle, but again, she instead goes to her turtle position.
McElhane now afforded a position on top of less than a minute to go. We'll see if she can make the most of this.
And again, we see her cinching in that head and arm position. That's really great for dragging an opponent down onto their belly, pulling them down. Now, Spencer reads it and is back up on her feet. Great fight.
McElhane backed up by a combination from Spencer. It's been a torrid pace here. Needs another high kick from Felicia Spencer.
Look at these two. They are leaving everything in the cage here tonight, TJ.
This is exactly what you want from a division that is growing. More right hands from Felicia Spencer. Madison McElhane is game, but she is on the run.
Yeah, and it looks like one of those shots may have hurt her. You know, I say that she comes right back with a right hand and a right elbow over the top.
Oh, more punches here from Spencer. McElhane backing up, head snapping back. Final 10 seconds here in this round. And big knee again by Spencer.
McElhane is still on the defense. She's using her underhook. She's spinning around. And oh, another takedown attempt at the end of this round. We saw some action.
Third and final round here between these featherweights. A lot of fireworks thus far through the first 10 minutes. Madison McElhane takes the center of the cage, and she's throwing the straight punches right down the middle.
Yeah, both of these fighters just really want to punch each other in the face, and I love it.
Spencer has landed the left high kick a few times. McElhane has walked right through it. And while the pace is slow, the aggression really hasn't.
No, you can see McElhane, she really relies on that jab to right hand, really hard. You know, they're still beginners, TJ. They're still working their way through this, but man, you can see the heart and you can see the potential of really great fighters coming out of this match.
Eric Haber on Twitter, he sees that exact same thing. And this is a division that is growing. These fighters very young in their campaigns, and this is a fun fight. This is a lot of fun because these ladies are leaving it all out there. That one misses, but again, that spin attack from Spencer, it's on the table there, and McElhane has to respect it.
And we're not seeing the frenetic pace that we saw before, but we still have two people who refuse to disengage, who want to continue to fight, continue to strike each other until one woman is left standing.
For a long time, this division has been talked about as a division with only a handful of stars. It's growing, it's getting bigger, it's getting better, largely because of athletes like the two we're watching right now.
Yeah, and here we are at the ground level, seeing the future possible Chris Cyborgs coming up, the future Megan Andersons, or at least the future contenders for them in, you know, in whatever happens in their careers. These women are putting it all on the line, and I'm extremely happy for this weight class.
More action here, Spencer firing forward into the clinch. So much fun here between these two featherweights.
Now, McElhane was grabbed around the head. Spencer pushed it off. She's using her head pressure to get to a better position. McElhane has been grabbing at limbs a lot, trying to trap wrists, trying to trap arms and armpits in this so that she can kind of slow down the pace of those striking exchanges. She's looking for her trips. She's looking for her takedowns right now, and rightly so. I think that would behoove her right now.
On Saturday, April 8th, Daniel Cormier and Anthony Johnson will rematch for the UFC Light Heavyweight Championship. It is UFC 210 live only on pay-per-view. 10 in the East and 7 in the West.
Very nice knee right there.
McElhane able to get herself off the fence. Now back at space. Spencer coming forward with punches. McElhane answering with a combination of her own.
And we can see they're getting a little bit tired here. Spencer is continuing to push forward. McElhane is still trying to find her shots on there. Beautiful wheel kick attempt, but that was the third attempt this fight. I would say maybe let that one go now. Do what you're doing well, which is these knees, it's these punches and these strikes off of clinch positions. That's what's working extremely well for Felicia Spencer.
McElhane now muscling Spencer up against the fence. This is a position where they've really gone 50-50. What does either woman need to do to really secure that position if they get back in the fence?
I think to secure that position, the woman has to have a very strong underhook. She's also got to really keep fighting and get that head position proper. You can see Felicia Spencer does a very good job with her head positioning. Now, she's trying to drag McElhane to the ground, but unfortunately, she gave up her head right there. McElhane is going again, trying to trap her. This is a great position to drag your opponent down, to rip on their head.
McElhane has employed that front headlock position a few times here, but Spencer has been able to get free every time. And McElhane has been afforded the opportunity to be on top of the final 90 seconds, minute of each round, but hasn't been able to capitalize on it. We'll see if she can do something here, because I gotta believe that she's down in the judges' scorecards at this point.
Yeah, you know, she's been backing up a little bit more. She's been on the receiving end of some pretty hard shots and some takedowns, but I wouldn't say that that's maybe a testament to her fighting ability, because man, this woman is really trying hard tonight, and she's landing some power shots. You can hear her corner calling for pressure, and that's exactly what she needs to do. Win the fight, pushing forward. Don't give Felicia Spencer the room for those kicks, the room to take control of the center of the cage and push her to the cage. Oh, nice shot.
McElhane trying to will herself here through some of this punishment and continue going. She's very tired, but she's far from out of this fight. No quit in this young lady. Now Felicia Spencer on top. I think she has secured the full mount.
Yeah, I think she took control of this fight about 6 seconds ago, like really control of these exchanges. She was able to try a toss and then go to the trip takedown. Now she's full mounted, and you know, again, McElhaney's in a good position not to be completely smashed in the head, but she's giving that roll off armbar. She's giving up her back now, and Felicia Spencer is obviously the dominant fighter now.
This time, Spencer elected to stay on the back, maybe try to land some ground and pound, final 10 seconds.
She's a little high on the back to maintain that position. She can't really break her down right now, so she's using her legs. McElhane very rightly is trying to shake off a hook and move over. A little bit too late at this point.
While Felicia Spencer was in control of majority of this fight, Madison McElhane was far from out of it. She never quit. This is a nice statement for this division growing forward. There's going to be a winner and a loser here announced in a moment, but I can't wait to see both of these athletes continue to grow.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards. Here are the totals. Both Ross Swanberg and Fernando Marquez have it 30-27. Brett Miller has it 29-28. All for your winner by unanimous decision, and still undefeated, Felicia Phenom Spencer.
Said it on the podcast this week, Julie, this was a bit of a sleeper for potential fight of the night.
Yeah, we're seeing two very young fighters, but two very strong fighters coming in here with incredible backgrounds as amateurs.
Holliday rushing forward, knee to the body inside the clinch here.
That was nicely done by Holliday. Nice read there. Miranda Maverick went for those double underhooks. She's very strong in that position.
You talk about the wrestling background of Holliday and the strength of Maverick. Can any of that strength, you know, nullify the wrestling pedigree of Holliday?
I mean, at times in positions, but a good wrestler is always going to read your weight. They're going to read your head position, so you can muscle out of the first throw, the second throw, but the third throw is still going to be coming there.
I also don't want to disrespect the strength of Cal Holliday either. She might be the stronger woman. It'll be interesting to talk to these ladies after the fight to see how the strength of the other one felt.
And that was a nice elbow over the top here. Now we're seeing Miranda Maverick up against the fence, and she showed to us in her debut with Invicta that she's very well balanced in this position. She doesn't get stressed out. She doesn't get freaked out by being put on one leg or another leg. She's able to shift her weight very easily in that sort of bad position.
Punch off the break for Maverick lands. Now back at the center of the cage is Holliday making Maverick on the perimeter. Nice right hand, left hook misses for Holliday. Holliday ducks back in now. The head is isolated here for Maverick, arm in though, and not really able to get the grip on that choke as of yet. Oh, beautifully done by Cal Holliday.
Yeah, she read that perfectly. That positioning, when you have the head and the arm like that, it does put you at a disadvantage with your weight up a little bit higher. And that was very nicely done by Cal Holliday.
Maverick able to get back, trying to get a half guard here.
And there's a little bit of blood coming from the nose of Maverick right now. I think that may have come from that over-the-top elbow strike earlier.
Now, while Maverick is on bottom here, sometimes perceived as a disadvantage, this is her world. She started at jiu-jitsu and should be at home here, but 50 Cal Holliday on top of you, that's not a fun position to be in.
No, she moves around a lot. She's very aggressive, but we can see Maverick is climbing up her legs into a triangle position. So she has the head and the arm of Cal Holliday trapped right now. It's not a full triangle left arm, and her head is exposed. Holliday's taking good advantage of that with some really strong left elbows there. Now the arm is being locked up. Cal Holliday is in an armbar right now. She's trying to push her way out of it, but Maverick has it locked in under her armpit, and she's extending hard on that elbow. But we can see Cal Holliday is getting to her feet. She's trying to shuck it off. That elbow is extended right now, TJ.
That looks very deep, Julie. Now Holliday trying to
come
around it. Maverick just goes belly down. Fully extended armbar. Cal Holliday wisely moves. Nicely done here, but that arm is still extended.
It
is done! Miranda Maverick with an armbar finish at 50, Cal Holliday.
That was incredible. She held that armbar the entire time, being slammed, immediately rolled to belly down. Beautiful read on the ground from Miranda Maverick.
Ladies and gentlemen, the armbar submission comes at the official time, 3:01. Round number one. We have your winner. She is still undefeated. Springfield's own, the Maverick, Miranda Maverick.
It is Mallory Martin meeting the Tsunami, Sunna Davíðsdóttir. Jab by Davíðsdóttir lands early. Martin took the center of the cage right away, but now eating some punches. Left hook lands nicely by Davíðsdóttir.
And Davíðsdóttir has a very long game, so it's good for Mallory Martin to get there in the clinch and try to throw her own knees and kind of nullify that. But I will say, I remember Sunna Davíðsdóttir's her underhook game is very sharp. She knows what to do with her arms on the inside.
Following that jab again is Davíðsdóttir. Martin firing some punches of her own. Credit to her. I mean, she came out, took the center of the cage aggressively and ate a really hard punch, but that hasn't broken her aggressive posture and her, you know, need and desire to take the center of the cage.
It hasn't, and if you watch, when she punches, she's out very quickly after those exchanges. She does a very nice job with her footwork and her timing there. Takedown attempt and a... Oh, we're still clinched up. We're still doing some takedown attempts here from a double leg defense. Now we're up against the cage.
Just getting word that we're actually on television tonight in Iceland. So hello to all of our viewers over there watching their pride and joy here. And Sunna Davíðsdóttir do some work. She gets the clinch. And you mentioned that underhook game. She has the left underhook, I think double unders here, Julie.
Yeah, and she ties one arm around the other a lot of the time. She does a really good job of adjusting her grip and maintaining control with the placement of her hands and the, you know, the way she grabs her wrists. Now, she is pushed up against, you can see her forehead is controlling Maverick up against the fence. Maverick standing very tall right now, but also trying to adjust her grips, trying to find a position where she can shuck off and find her strikes. Nice little knee exchange right there. I don't know why that's split up. Oh, okay. It looked like one of those knees was to the groin. I missed that positioning.
All right, so referee Mike England intervenes. Now we're back at space. Enjoy live and exclusive events, original programming, and the largest MMA library on UFC Fight Pass. Download the UFC.tv app today, anytime, anywhere, is your pass to the Ultimate Fighting Championship. Martin pushing forward, trying to get into the clinch, and Davíðsdóttir gets it. The corner of Martin said, patience, Mallory, maybe getting a bit too aggressive.
Beautiful. Now, that's why grabbing over the head is very dangerous, ladies and gentlemen at home. You can get some epic tosses off that, but if somebody reads it, they can just push you right back in, into a vulnerable spot. We've got a really interesting scramble going on here where both still have a hold of the other's head. Now, both are back on their feet. We hear Mallory Martin's corner calling for her to shoot right now.
You can't make a mistake in the clinch with Sunna Davíðsdóttir as well. We talk about that clinch game. It's been on point, and Sunna Davíðsdóttir remains dominant here in this position. Now, again, clinching Martin up against the fence.
You can see Davíðsdóttir is also controlling. She's grabbing onto the wrist. You can see a wrist control game there. Grip is so important when you're on your feet as well as when you're on the ground. Nice elbow there. Grip can change an entire fight.
Davíðsdóttir lands a right hand, now moves back to space, disengaged. Another right hand.
Yeah, she's putting a lot of power into those right hands. Nice kick there. Mallory Martin seems unfazed by the power shots at this point.
When you train in Thailand and get that Muay Thai practice, and I'm sure she's gotten used to taking a lot of punishment and exchanging on the feet. So Sunna Davíðsdóttir, while she has a lot of power behind these strikes, as long as the lights are on, Mallory Martin's going to say,
lights might not be on anymore. Hard left hand by Davíðsdóttir.
Oh, that was so beautifully timed. You can see Mallory Martin trying to get right back in there, trying to take her down, understanding she's wobbly and she's in danger. She's got to switch her position. Now up against the fence and eating knees.
Look at the composure, though, for Mallory Martin. She's still with it. She's still cognizant, defending intelligently. That's the most important thing for her to do here. And Davíðsdóttir comfortable in this clinch. Now breaks. We'll see what happens again on the feet. That was dangerous for Mallory Martin a moment ago.
Yeah, that left hook. It looks like the way she's dropping her her hand, she's got that left hook to be to be taken advantage of. Mallory Martin is pushing forward though.
Lands a nice left hand of her own. The corner of Martin telling her not to chase her. Don't get over aggressive. Don't let her counter. Coming up on 30 seconds remaining here in this first round.
Big breath from Sunna Davíðsdóttir right there. You know, you kind of wonder if she kind of got overly excited when she saw the wobble and really kind of used up a lot of explosive energy. You can see the left eye of Mallory Martin is swelling up now. Oh, nice leg shot.
Heavy kick to the lead leg of Mallory Martin. Final 10 seconds here in this opening round. Strawweights inside the Invicta FC cage. Martin goes for a takedown.
That was actually very well timed. Sunna read the attack, but she went right underneath Sunna's strike right there.
5 minutes in the book. Sunna Davíðsdóttir had Mallory Martin rocked, but unable to get the finish. Sunna Davíðsdóttir was motioning to Mike England about something on the floor there, but now the fight is underway.
Yeah, it's probably a little bit of water. Sometimes it can get pretty slippery out there, especially with logos. You need the logos on the cage, but canvas can kind of, it can make for a slippery environment with water on it.
We see that eye of Mallory Martin swelling up. How much is that going to be a target for Davíðsdóttir throwing, you know, punches and kicks from that right side?
You know, I believe it's going to be a target, but the actual the left hook will land on the other side, and that was the effective punch right there. So it may be that she wants to take advantage of a bit of blindness there, but I think it's the hook that's going to be doing the damage.
Left hand gets through again. Appreciate you watching, everyone on Fight Pass. James re-upping his subscription. We appreciate that.
Nice knee there from Mallory Martin,
A lot of action here in this fight. A lot of action still yet to go. Tonya Evinger, Yana Kunitskaya looking to settle their business in our main event. And right now, these strawweights vying for some positioning in this 115-pound division.
Oh, that was a nice wrench there. She's pulling Sunna Davíðsdóttir off of her balance there with that overhook.
Martin's still going forward. Davíðsdóttir throwing a lot of punches, a lot of strikes at her, landing. And it's Martin that's just coming forward. That's got to be a little bit disheartening for Davíðsdóttir a little bit.
Yeah, and I think that kind of pressure, that I do think that comes a lot from Muay Thai. There's a lot of moving forward, you know, staying light on your feet and constant pressure forward so that you can get your shot in. A lot of kicks and knees come from forward pressure, not backward pressure, right?
Another kick to the lead leg of Martin. She fires back with some punches. We've seen a lot of clinch work here. Davíðsdóttir content to, at least for a few moments, fight from space, and for good reason. That left hand has landed twice right there, Julie, with some hard power behind it.
Yeah, it's beautifully done. Mallory Martin carries her right hand just a bit low, just enough space so that Sunna Davíðsdóttir can work the left side of her body and come with that, her own left hook to the right side of her chin. And that would be Mallory Martin's chin. Tough chin though, right?
Absolutely. She walked through some of Davíðsdóttir's best punches and strikes in this bout, coming up in the halfway point of the second round in this fight.
She's kind of like a little tank, just pushing forward like that. And you know, it might be working on the gas tank a little bit sooner, Davíðsdóttir.
We said Martin is going to keep coming forward as long as the lights are on. They were almost shut off in the first round, but again, pressing forward. And, you know, she loves this game. While even though she's taking punishment, she's still not getting off of her strategy and what she wants to do in this fight.
And that may pay dividends for her.
Oh, beautiful left hand by Martin. Stumbled Davíðsdóttir now inside the clinch.
2 minutes of work here for Martin.
Drop your level when you get a chance, Mallory.
Davíðsdóttir getting that left underhook. Martin trying to shuck her to the side, but this is Davíðsdóttir's world.
And she's grabbing her on the head like that. I would almost wish when the head goes to, oh, nice shuck to body positioning. She's pressuring, though, Mallory Martin. She's pressuring with that right forearm so she can land an elbow over the top. Sunna Davíðsdóttir seems to have her feet back under, but she also seems tired. She's taking big breaths right now. A large shot can kind of hurt your cardio as well.
Martin measuring here. She knows the significance of this moment in this fight. 90 seconds left in round number two.
And we heard Mallory Martin's corner calling for her to be patient, be patient. I wonder if they know that she can just take a lot of punishment and win at the end. Some fighters have that strategy. I don't know how, you know, how well that always plays out for people, but it seems to be Mallory Martin is taking over some of the action right here. She's got the pressure moving now. She's hitting the shots.
Lee used to say, oh, another strike wobbles Davíðsdóttir. Martin coming forward, but again, very measured. Blood leaking from the eye, I believe, of Davíðsdóttir. Now in the clinch. Big knee.
Nice knee from Mallory Martin.
Left and a right hand by Martin. Davíðsdóttir is hurt, weathering this storm.
Her feet are too close together right there, Sunna Davíðsdóttir. Mallory Martin can actually drop down for a shot. She can warm her up with some knees right there. But right now, Sunna Davíðsdóttir's in some serious danger.
Beautiful standing elbows. Davíðsdóttir covering up. Martin trying to make it count. 30 seconds left for the Colorado native to do work, but now it's Davíðsdóttir that gets the plum. Right hand off on the break. Neither of these ladies going away after taking some insane punishment.
Very nice
done there by Martin. Lowered her elevation, now in the guard of Davíðsdóttir. 13 seconds left. Wow, Julie, this is a fantastic fight.
It really is. Mallory Martin is making a beautiful recovery from that. Really showing her game here. Now we see Sunna Davíðsdóttir is doing a great job on the ground. She's moving her hips to the side, but not enough to actually lock on a submission there at the end. Very well done by Mallory Martin, calling the crowd to recognize what she's accomplishing there in the cage. Great fight between these two strawweights.
5 minutes left to keep the judges out of it. Mallory Martin, Sunna Davíðsdóttir, even thus far on our cards for 10 minutes, and this is shaping up to be a classic.
Right, and we're seeing that long stance from Davíðsdóttir. Her hands up pretty well there, but you know, again, we've got Mallory Martin now. She's kind of this, I guess, the little tank. She just keeps pushing forward and finding those shots. She does not want to go backwards.
We've got Iceland in the cage. Phuket, Thailand, represented by the Denver, Colorado native, and Mallory Martin in Australia checking in on Twitter. Appreciate the love. Hashtag InvictaFC22.
That was a nice little lead hand uppercut from Sunna Davíðsdóttir. I'd like to see a lot more of that. Again, I think her left hand is her power shot, as is Mallory Martin's at this point.
Left hand again got through by Davíðsdóttir, really throwing it, missing. Right hand by the Iceland native.
Goodness.
Martin landing as well. Straw weights can bang, ladies and gentlemen, and these two ladies are putting on a show.
They really are. This is, when you think of the strawweight division, beautiful takedown right there. Double leg attempt going into a trip, putting her on her butt. Sunna Davíðsdóttir now has to work her way back up to her feet. She's trying to do that by leveraging on the head, but Mallory Martin is hitting strikes along the way.
Mallory Martin said, yeah, I'm training with the Muay Thai team and I'm getting really on point with my strikes, but you know, I'm a well-rounded mixed martial artist. She showed that wrestling game off there a moment ago. Davíðsdóttir able to get to her feet, but Martin still making it uncomfortable. Now we're back at space. Davíðsdóttir came out a little bit aggressive. I think she knows that she might be down. Now she's turning it on. Martin trying to reverse the position, get a takedown. Wizard here. Nice control.
Really, really well done by Mallory Martin. And Sunna Davíðsdóttir, I'm so impressed with her tenacity right there. Like I said, I always think her underhooks, or I've said before, her underhooks are really very good. Mallory Martin is reading the underhooks and she's launching her with overhook technique.
Scrambles like that, Julie, in this fight, a close fight, can really mean the difference between a win and a loss. So battling through that, not giving up position, is very important for both of these ladies. Now, again, on the feet, Martin stalking forward.
Now, Mallory Martin is really controlling the cage at this point. She's forcing Sunna Davíðsdóttir to adjust to her fakes and feints. Now, Sunna Davíðsdóttir, again, her length is great. Her punches are landing. I guess one of every three or one of every two punches is landing, which is a good percentage. However, I think that she's playing Mallory Martin's game in a lot of ways.
Absolutely. We've seen power from both of these ladies. Davíðsdóttir back inside the clinch. Under 2.5 remain here in our final round.
Oh, my goodness.
A hard right
hand. There was the underhook doing its magic right there. That was really well. well done. Sunna Davis' daughter is on Mallory Martin's back right now.
Is she too high here, Julie?
She's high in the back, and she has her hooks in, and she has her arms underneath Mallory Martin's arms, which is a good way to maintain that position. However, Mallory Martin can roll her off. She is still a little high. Right now, Sunna Davis, she really needs to find a way to stay on top of her. Isolating an arm, looking for a roll-off armbar is what I would suggest at this point. However, grabbing underneath the armpits like that is going to keep her on her back for now.
Touch over 90 seconds here for Davíðsdóttir. She's able to secure this position. It could be.
Oh, there she is trying for the armbar.
Martin wise to it. Able to get free. Now she's trying to secure position. Davíðsdóttir cut, bloody, battered, still in this though.
Fantastic pressure from Mallory Martin.
Wow. Back to the feet. These straw weights are showing what 115 pounds is all about.
Sunna Davíðsdóttir covered with blood and still slinging those power shots.
I would not want to be a judge right now, Julie Kedzie.
I would not want to be on the receiving end of either of these two in their punches.
Both of these ladies still very much in and exchanging punches. The corner of Martin asking her to shoot, she does. Davíðsdóttir able to stuff the takedown.
Look at that, both of them are going for head position. Both of them are pushing off for those nice little elbows inside the clinch too.
Final 45 seconds left in this contest. Every bit of positional dominance is gonna be very, very important here when the judges render their decision. I've got Martin slightly ahead thus far in this round, but it can all be nullified by a good combination. Very even, Julie.
I am so impressed with both of these fighters, TJ. I don't even want to know what the score is. I just want to see them hit each other.
Martin's corner begging for her to throw strikes up top. Takedown attempt by Martin, stuffed by Davíðsdóttir. Dying seconds here of this third and final round. Knee by Davíðsdóttir. Wow.
Oh my goodness. What a fight.
You cannot tell me that there is a loser in this fight.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three incredible rounds, we go to the scorecards one more time. Kansas City, put your hands together for both of these warriors. And here are the judges' totals. Henry Gary has it 30-27. Fernando Marquez and Ross Swanberg see it 29-28. All three for your winner by unanimous decision, Sunna Tsunami Davíðsdóttir!
The tsunami reigns supreme. Sunna Davíðsdóttir victorious via unanimous decision. In the Invicta FC cage, it is Smashley, Ashley Cummins, and the bully, Amber Brown. Cummins immediately comes out, takes the center of the cage, throwing some straight punches. Brown threw a kick to the lead leg, but ate some punches for her effort.
Yeah, she came charging right in there. You know, what we've seen from Smashley in the past is a lot of quick little punches to a clinch position or to a takedown position, and it looks like she's trying to push Amber into a defensive mind. Nice right hand there from Smashley.
Quick, crisp punches from Smashley here. Looping overhand left, misses for Brown. Now in the clinch.
And this is where Brown does very, very well. She's a tall fighter. She has great dirty boxing and some really long knees that she's able to hit people with.
This little forearm on the inside there by Smashley, but Brown trying to dictate the pace here in the clinch. They exchange position over under here. There's the happy warrior, Roxanne Modafferi, chiming in on Twitter. Always fun to see her.
We see Amber Brown had the double underhook. She's able to lock a body position and trip Ashley to the ground. Now she's in top. She's actually in a full mount, and she's got her legs around there.
Who is
bleeding
blood
right now?
I think it might be Amber Brown. They may have clashed heads when they hit the floor.
Oh, nicely done there by Smashley to get out of the mount. Amber Brown is still on top. She's putting a lot of pressure on the neck of Amber. Ashley Cummins right now. I'm distracted by the blood, TJ. I can't see the cut.
Yeah, I believe it's over the right eye, but we haven't got a good shot at it yet. Cummins able to get a good look here and get her guard back. Might be her nose, the trunk is telling me. A half butterfly position here for Cummins.
Yeah, and she's still, yeah, with that butterfly position in there, she's not able to elevate because of the positioning of Amber Brown's body over the top of her. She needs to get a little space to push her away, and she does. Now, Amber Brown's very good on top. She's able to fight through that, but unfortunately, she puts herself right back into the guard. She's got an arm extended. Ashley has that arm trapped. She lets it go.
Full guard now for Cummins. I don't know if it's locked up quite yet. No, it's not. Foot on the hip.
She's pushing at the elbow. She's wrapped up into a triangle. Very nicely done. She's got that triangle position locked down. I'm not sure how deep it is. It looks like the legs are actually in the opposite direction where I want them to go. It's a great way to draw blood from Amber Brown to really put pressure on the head since she's spurting out.
Cummins saying something to Greg Franklin. Trying to get a look at something now. Brown's in trouble. She's trying to go out the back door.
Her neck is not trapped right now, but her arm is.
Cummins staying tough with this. Now she's getting it on top for her troubles.
And now we see the triangle. We've got a double triangle, ladies and gentlemen.
Now Brown is free, but she's still holding on to that inverted triangle of her own. Now locking it up.
Very
would this be
nicely
something?
Done, Amber Brown. Ashley Cummins is still in top position, but her head is trapped and her arm is trapped. She's got to get enough pressure to off of her chin. Those legs are long and they're hard. What she's doing right now, when she's stepping on the top of Amber Brown, she's trying to relieve that pressure. She's trying to get to a position where she can free her head.
The fence not in a good position here for Ashley Cummins trying to get free, but I think she's loosened up the pressure a little bit, but Brown is hanging tough with it.
She is. You know, she's got those tremendously long legs. Nice punches there, but unfortunately her arm being out there can get trapped, just as Amber Brown has done. Ashley Cummins has some great composure right here, still fighting, still looking for a way to be offensive from top position, even without her head in position.
Amber Brown trying to figure out if she can do anything with the right arm of Ashley Cummins, a unique position to be in.
And I actually think attacking that wrist is a good idea. Ashley Cummins needs a position to base from. I don't think her neck is trapped anymore. I think her neck is trapped. I don't think her neck is in danger of being choked.
She's about free, and she is now nicely done by Amber Brown. What a technical exchange here on the floor.
Yeah, she had great composure right there. A lot of inversion here happening. A lot of, now we're in a body triangle kind of position.
Brown gives up position, trying to do a hammer fist.
And it's just balance to triangle, balance to triangle. It's who can be on top and who can sweep the other.
It's the oddest bit of chain wrestling I've ever seen in my life.
I love this.
30 seconds again, now a switch of positions. Brown trying to get out of this position, I think, to try to make it a little more regular. Now I'm playing the leg game.
What creativity here. You know, they're just looking for a position to trap and a hit, to trap and a hit, and both of them are employing exactly the same strategy.
Cummins has a triangle with the arm and leg trap almost. It's not necessarily a triangle, but it's I don't know what it is, Julie. Honestly, it's crazy business here. A bit of innovation ends the round. Wow. All right, round number two, ready to go. Ashley Cummins, Amber Brown. Cummins takes the center of the cage immediately.
Cummins is actually fighting very, she's fighting a smart game by trying to get in the inside of those long limbs. Beautiful single leg off that kick. Amber Brown immediately tries to reverse it. Ashley manages to stay on top of the guard. Her arm is trapped, however.
We've seen Brown very dangerous on her back before. She submitted Chino Van Hoosh last year.
And Ashley Cummins is no slouch right here. You know, in a lot of her fights, we see her on top guard position, but kind of turtle like that, delivering the sharp shots.
Trying to play a little bit of rubber guard was Amber Brown now, brings it high. Cummins trying to posture up through it. Tommy Toehold chiming in on Twitter.
I love you, Tommy. Jiu-jitsu is absolutely correct. And look at that, you know, that attempt for an armbar in that pass. Now Amber Brown is in a position where, and she's trying to get her butt underneath her a little bit more to get more leverage to sweep, but also trapping the head in hopes of getting those positions. Looks like she's trying to climb her right leg up to a high guard. Not advisable when the other leg is trapped. Head and arm position.
Cummins trying to get free from the guard as well. Now inside with that arm triangle, Brown trying to get that right arm free.
Now she's doing the quote-unquote answer the phone technique there. She's trying to create space with her elbow up there, but that seems like it's kind of tight right now. She's struggling, you know, she's bridging a little bit, but I don't know. I think that choke
She's lost the position a little bit. And it looked like Brown was trying to wait for her to maybe try to step over and sweep the position. But Cummins biding her time, securing the position. Now she doesn't have the choke, but she is in a dominant side.
Now Cummins in top position right here. Again, good chance to throw those little strikes. Try to work her way, work those points up in the bank, and cause a little damage.
On Saturday, April 8th, Daniel Cormier and Anthony Johnson will rematch for the UFC Light Heavyweight Championship. It is UFC 210 live on pay-per-view. 10 in the East and 7 in the West.
Now look, Ashley Cummins actually has that position locked up. It's not a full choke from here, but you can see the way Amber Brown is actually up. She's basing out with her elbow, trying to create more space, trying to create more pressure, but Ashley is very relentless on that head and arm choke. She's really trying to push, driving across the mount.
Neon Belly slides over to mount, still holding that choke. Amber Brown putting her toes in the cage there, trying to make space.
Beautifully done by Ashley Cummins. That's the side you want to be on to finish that choke. You want to be the opposite side. Amber Brown is grabbing onto her leg, trying to relieve the pressure. Again, that's a great way to defend this. Ashley is switching her grip, she's continuing to work. But Amber Brown, she's thrashed a little bit, making it uncomfortable for Ashley to keep her flat. Do not want to be flat right there in that choke position.
The thrashing is a sign of desperation, I think, trying to get free. Now Brown is grabbing that right leg, trying to get the circulation going, trying to make some space.
And what Ashley really needs to do right now is get her chest to the ground. Her chest is what counts right there.
That's real
she's
deep now.
She's raising up, but she's a little too high, I think, to finish right here.
I think she lost the elbow position. Now Amber Brown trying to go out the back door. She brought her legs up into the mix and making space. This is one of the more technical matchups you'll ever see in mixed martial arts, Julie. Crazy stuff.
And that was fantastic patience for Amber Brown. Fantastic defense, staying calm in the storm when there was a lot of pressure on her neck. And it was great pressure from Ashley Cummins. That's exactly what you need to do.
A minute left here in round number two. And while the choke didn't come for Ashley Cummins, a significant amount of dominance has come within this round. This will clearly be her round unless something crazy happens here in the final minute.
Yeah, and look at the way Amber Brown inserts those butterfly hooks. Ashley is reading that and stepping away from them, but those long legs and butterfly hooks are a fantastic way to elevate people, to keep your opponent even in top position, to keep them always guessing what's coming next.
Nice elbow there by Cummins. Brown has a little elbow of her own. 30 seconds here in round number two. I think we're seeing a lot of evolution from both of these fighters here. And you know, that just innovation that they've had on the ground is really great stuff. And again, we're far from done in this one. 15 seconds left in round number two. Brown trying to get free.
And Ashley Cummins just maintaining that beautiful top pressure, even when her head gets trapped like that. Even when the person underneath her is squirming, she's like, no, I am solid, I am staying here. 105 is definitely the place for Ashley Cummins to be.
We've been singing the praises of straw weights. Now I want to sing the praises of atom weights, because a former straw weight, both of these ladies, former straw weights, putting on a show though tonight at 105 pounds.
She needs to cause pain for her opponent and not get overwhelmed by the top pressure. That's what's going on with her. She's on the defense too much. She needs to take over, really take the center of the ring and start delivering those strong strikes that she has.
Ashley Cummins coming out very aggressive, feinting a lot, lowering her elevation, making Brown think about the shot. Right hand lands for Cummins.
And the way Cummins is darting in and out like that, that's beautiful against a longer opponent, a taller opponent.
Appreciate Amanda's kind comments there on Twitter, hashtag InvictaFC22, at TJ DeSantis, at JulesK_fighter, and of course, at InvictaFights.
And we saw a nice left hook land there from Ashley Cummins. Brown seems, she seems a little trepidatious, but then she comes in there and rattles off three punches in a row to the face, so.
Blood leaking from the nose of Amber Brown. Still firing forward, though. I like the movement from Cummins. She's employed a shot in this fight a few times. She's taken Brown down, but also thrown shots with her hands. And Brown, I think, is forced to react here more than act her own.
The way Ashley Cummins is staying so light on her feet, like I said, the in and out movement, it's throwing Amber off of that aggressive game. Usually she's the aggressor, usually she's the one moving forward, you know, and now she's the one who's primarily defensive right now. Not that she's not landing her own shots, she is, But we see one person is bleeding pretty heavily right now, and the other one has, I think, a little bit of a trickle around her ear, which may not even be her blood.
Now back in the clinch, Cummins trying to bully the bully. Brown has none of it, pushes away. See, in all areas of mixed martial arts, a lot of ground positioning for the first 10 minutes. Now we're seeing the kickboxing effect.
Yeah, and I like seeing those kicks from Amber Brown. I'd like to see her mix it up a little bit. She's throwing some pretty good front kicks in the first couple rounds. Those head kicks, they're very nasty when she throws them. She might be cautious of the takedown right now off of the kick as she was single-legged in the second round.
Brown now bunching up some kicks. This combination by Brown, but Cummins still coming forward. Single leg attempt here.
Beautiful.
Executed well. Brown tries to roll through.
Oh, and Amber Brown's in the armbar. Oh, excuse me. Ashley Cummins is in the armbar. Amber Brown put it on there, but Ashley defends quickly. She's passing over, able to pass the guard and defend that arm pretty quickly. Now, those long legs of Amber Brown, like wrapping them around people's heads when she shouldn't be able to, it's a huge strength of hers and a huge, you know, creative decision on her part.
Cummins now with a clean side. Grinding that forearm against the face of Brown. Brown now trying to move, but might be giving up that arm triangle position again. Corner of Cummins asking for a crucifix. He wants to isolate that arm potentially, get some ground and pound in, but now looks like she's gonna try to take the back of Amber Brown. She does.
Well done. Amber Brown was turning over, trying to get a more shrimp position there. Now she's all the way on her back. She does not have both hooks in quite yet, but it looks like, you know, she's in a pretty good backpack position here to ride Amber Brown and to try to bully the bully, like you said, yanking her backwards.
Time not on the side of Amber Brown here. If she's gonna make something happen, she needs to go quickly. I think she's trying to frame up. I thought she was trying to go for a Kimura. She's not. And now you gotta watch out again. Ashley Cummins trying to come out on top. I think she was trying to keep that arm triangle as she did, but Brown now goes again to her base.
What a beautiful ride that Ashley Cummins is doing, like a little koala bear, just staying on top, finding her openings, finding her ways to grab. She's high on the back. We've seen that a lot tonight. People are really exploiting that backdoor escape, but she's able to ride on top. When you get your arms underneath your opponent's arms, you can ride them a little bit better. I keep saying ride them, but I think you guys know what I mean at home. It's almost like the person is a jungle gym and you have to climb around them and find the places to put your feet and hands.
Final 30 seconds left in this atomweight fight. Amber Brown trying to get free from Ashley Cummins. Cummins holding on.
This is by far one of Ashley Cummins's, I think, most impressive performances.
She's a bona fide atomweight. Now she's trying to get it done with the rear naked choke. 15 seconds left for Ashley Cummins to get a stoppage, putting on the squeeze.
It's not under the chin, but it is bringing the blood, and that's a good psychological move right there, especially for the judges to see.
Couple right hands, not a lot behind them, but time is running out, and it has expired. 15 minutes in the books. Ashley Cummins has done enough on my scorecard to get this fight, but wow, I'm saying it all night long. Our athletes are performing. I feel bad that there's a loser because they're both, wow, just truly, this is top shelf mixed martial arts.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards. Here are the totals. Ross Swanberg has it 30-27. Henry Gary and Brett Miller have it 29-28, all for your winner by unanimous decision. From St. Louis, Missouri, smashing Ashley Cummins!
Joined now by the undisputed Invicta FC featherweight champion of the world, Megan Anderson. Megan, appreciate you stopping by Cape Side. We are underway, 3 5-minute rounds scheduled. Let me get your mic on here in a moment. Big day for you, now officially the undisputed champion. What's that like? You get that interim label drop?
I'm definitely excited. I think it needed to happen, when Chris moved to the UFC, but I'm glad that it's happened now and it's all cleared up.
Some exchanges here early on the feet. Had a lot of action tonight, just crazy action. I don't expect it to slow here at all, Megan. What are your thoughts on the fights this evening?
I think these fights have been incredible. This is a very, very well-matched card. The team here at Invicta do an amazing job matching them, and the fighters themselves have pulled through.
Bennett with the lead kick to the leg of Esquibel. Esquibel firing some hands back.
And I think Esquibel needs to make DeAnna Bennett miss right now. She needs to make her not grab onto her. DeAnna Bennett's wrestling is very good. Her cage wrestling is very good as well. Esquibel's got fantastic strikes, and she needs to read DeAnna and really find her shots on the inside of Deanna's long shots.
Punch to the body there by Esquibel, followed with a left hook to the head. Megan, you're a striker. We've seen you put on a show inside the Invicta FC cage. When you're looking at the way that Esquibel is firing off punches, she's not afraid to throw first to the body and then to the head. What do you think of that combination approach?
Yeah, I definitely think this is smart for Esquibel. She's the shorter fighter. She has the shorter reach, and she's going to have to mix it up between the head and the body to be able to get the strikes that she's wanting to land.
She has to be careful with her approach here with the strikes. Don't want to be open up for a takedown. Bennett, an accomplished wrestler. We've seen her wrestle not only just on the floor, but wrestle opponents up against the fence. And when she gets on the inside, sometimes she doesn't let go. She makes fun of her style a little bit, saying, like, I'm a hugging fighter. But, if she can bully you, it can go a long way in frustrating her opponent.
That unorthodox style—it's hard to replicate in the training room. It's hard to train for. So I think that this could work well for Bennett. But I think Esquibel really needs to double up on some of those punches to be able to get on the inside and execute her game plan.
Esquibel, nice left hand there, pawing with the jab. We mentioned the weight cut for DeAnna Bennett did not go the way that she wanted to. Hopefully for her, that doesn't affect her in the cardio game. We've seen Esquibel, she's a grinder. She will not go away without a fight. We saw that against Alexa Grasso. Grasso was really piecing her up in that fight, but Esquibel's will to fight never left.
No, it really didn't, and she definitely was on a hard loss off of that, off of some of those shots. She had to have, nose surgery from that fight, but she says she's actually the better for it. And sometimes, when you can breathe better in training, things work out very well. Oh. Nice dump there from Esquibel.
Bennett came high with a kick. It glanced the head of Jodie, but Jodie able to get the takedown now in the guard, stacking with a beautiful right hand. Bennett trying to pivot off her an armbar.
Yeah, this is a dangerous position for Jodie Esquibel. I know that she trains very hard on the ground. Bennett has been so successful with a lot of her armbars, tapping the likes of, I don't know if she tapped Liana Pena or she just broke her arm, but I remember it was a very successful submission for her in the past.
She's trying to do either right now to Jodie Esquibel. Esquibel biding her time, trying to clear danger here, trying to step over. A lot of time here for Bennett to work, but Esquibel now sinking her way down. Looks like she's going to clear that arm. No, it's deep. Wow,
oh my
that
goodness.
Is deep, that is extended. Jodie Esquibel in trouble. That arm is hyper extended. Jodie Esquibel, a warrior, accidentally kicking the face. Bennett calling it out. I think Jodie was trying to step over. Now she's pushing on the head of DeAnna Bennett again. Switching back to Evinger Kunitskaya, not illegal. You just cannot kick. It cannot be a strike.
Yeah, there was a little kick in there, but it looks like she was trying for that. Bennett still has that arm. Oh. She's still, really cranking on that.
DeAnna Bennett putting on a clinic here, attacking that arm.
The toughness,
yeah.
That was fully extended.
If she gets out of this, I don't know if that arm is going to be the same throughout the rest of this fight. It's still a lot of time for DeAnna Bennett to wrench on it.
Yeah,
30 seconds remain.
Look at Bennett's tenacity in that. Cranking the wrist back and forth is a great way to put that elbow in a good position. I don't know what she's saying to the ref right there. She's saying something. It may be being kicked in the face right there. Jodie's using her feet to really push on that face. It's up to the ref. It's up to Greg Franklin to call if he thinks that's illegal or not. One of those was definitely a kick. I don't know if it was deliberate or not, but, right now she's just cranking on that armbar.
Final 10 seconds here. I mean, it comes down to intent, I think.
Oh, she let go of the armbar now. Oh, I guess she noticed that it was the end of the round. Good gracious. So Jodie, that looked like a kick. It didn't look like it was aimed at the face, actually, but Bennett definitely called it as such. Showing a lot of toughness and a lot of tenacity from both fighters. I think it's got Bennett's blood boiling a little bit, thinking she might have been illegally hit.
That was a nice right hand by Bennett.
Round two underway. DeAnna Bennett, Jodie Esquibel. Megan Anderson joining myself, TJ DeSantis, Julie Kedzie announced today that Megan is the official undisputed Invicta FC featherweight champion. We had a nice Q&A conversation today, again available online, patreon.com/InvictaFC. So we're looking at that arm of Jodie Esquibel. It was extended, it was very deep. We'll see how functional it is going forward, because that was a scary position for Esquibel.
And we can see DeAnna Bennett was throwing that left high kick fairly successfully. I mean, she landed at least once, and that's where Esquibel got the dump. But I'm wondering if Esquibel's really wanting to put her back on the ground again if that kick comes up.
Beautiful head movement by Esquibel. I think those feints are definitely going to help her, trying to get on the inside of Bennett's jab.
Yeah, and there's something to be said that, you know, you already know the person's pissed off. You piss them off even more if they can't get a read on you to punch you.
Esquibel really hasn't thrown that right hand much this round, pawing with that jab. Kick again, there's the right hand from Esquibel. Another right hand there.
I think she's using her cage control very well. She seems to be backing Bennett up and using her strikes really well.
Esquibel catching the kick and then stepping, you know, back out of it, allowing Bennett to fall to the ground, have to get back up. A little bit of an expensive energy.
Esquibel doing well for being the shorter fighter in the reach department. She's getting on the inside, not paying too much from the counter-striking from Bennett.
I think that two straight to the body is setting everything up. She's using that beautifully, and I'm pretty sure she's every time she's thrown it, it's connected cleanly.
Coming up on the halfway point of this fight, Invicta FC 22, Jodie Esquibel, Deanna Bennett doing work, catchweight contest here tonight.
There's that right hand to the body again.
We've, you know, seeing the, I guess, the size disparity in these two fighters, seeing someone fight fast like Jodie is darting in and out, much like Ashley Cummins, though, Ashley was really excited to be on top and gripping her opponent. Esquibel really wants to be on the outside firing shots and then getting out of the way of those counter shots. You know, Bennett's been able to hit some pretty good right hands herself. Esquibel's cognizant of that, and so her movement is what's really going to pay dividends for her. I keep saying pay dividends, but it's true. It's all money in the bank when you're fighting.
Bennett now utilizing that reach a little bit, getting longer with her strikes. What would you like to see her do, Megan? You usually enjoy the reach advantage in your fights.
Yeah, I think she needs to commit to throwing that right hand a lot more. You know, she's utilizing the jab very well, but she's not following it up. As I say that, she follows it up with the right hand. I think just chaining those punches together, chaining those combinations, trying two, three, four combinations, you know, I think it's going to work more in her favor, because it looks like Esquibel's kind of dictating the pace of the fight right now.
Esquibel using that teep kick to almost like a jab, and not even throwing it fully, but having Bennett back up. Nice kick to the lead leg of Bennett by Esquibel, tripping up Greg Franklin a little bit. Better round here for Esquibel, keeping it up on the feet, not being defensive on the floor. Bennett trying to figure out Esquibel, who's been a bit unpredictable, moving, a lot of head movement for Jodie.
I think that's really worked for her this round. It's definitely set up all her major strikes, and I feel like she's come away with the better of the exchanges so far.
And I think Bennett's finding that the best strikes for her are going to be counters off of those strikes, right? When Esquibel does a 1-2-3 or something like that, Bennett's length can, if she just extends out and snaps at the end of them, she's able to find a target. Nice kick exchange right there.
Kick to the body for Bennett, then Esquibel fired off a kick of her own. Now Bennett turning up the volume here with these kicks. Esquibel noticed she was getting towards the perimeter of the cage and then just readjusted. She really wants to be in the center there. Why is Esquibel so adamant on being in the center of the cage here?
If she's pushed up against the cage by somebody who's stronger than her, who's longer than her, as is DeAnna Bennett, she can easily be taken back down up against the cage. DeAnna Bennett's cage wrestling is a big part of her game, right? You see her awkward wrestling, or however she likes to call it.
Here we go, TJ DeSantis, Julie Kedzie, the Invicta FC featherweight champion, Megan Anderson, joining us here inside the Scottish Rite Temple, Kansas City, Missouri, Invicta FC 22.
Now, Megan, it's been a really long time since I've entered that final round, but what kind of mentality do you have? I mean, is that when you get relaxed or is that when you get more intense?
That final round, if it's 50-50, I'm going in that round with I'm going to try and finish the fight. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that third round is very crucial for definitely a close fight like this fight has been. I think the winner of whoever wins the exchanges and of this round could potentially, you know, get the judge's score.
Nice left hand there by Esquibel, and she backs away back at space. I like Esquibel's movement here, Julie, always circling away from Bennett's power here.
Yeah, I do too, although she did get cracked a little bit right there. And that's, you know, what happens sometimes with those leg kicks, especially from a shorter fighter. The other person's far hand can reach you off of leg kick. Now, she read that and stepped right out of it right there.
That outside of Bennett's leg doesn't look too pleasant right now. I think if Jodie keeps targeting that leg, it's definitely going to be harder for her to take her to the ground.
So little right hands there for Bennett when she was hopping on a foot. Esquibel came in again. Jodie's doing a really good job being the shorter fighter, not reaching too much, not opening herself up for devastating counterpunches.
She is, and I think grabbing the leg like that, I think she, personally, I would dispense with that unless I'm trying a trip, unless I'm trying to dump the fighter. I wouldn't just grab, you know, to grab, because unfortunately she's at the end of those punches from that position.
Nice right hand again for Esquibel, finds a home. Bennett fires back a combination.
Really, motion is Jodie Esquibel's friend right now. Staying on a bicycle, staying around. I love the word darting, as you can tell tonight, because I think it's so important for these smaller fighters to understand the power they have to be little bumblebees.
Two-punch combination finds a home for Bennett. Esquibel comes in with a right hand.
And we're seeing Bennett really finding a home for her right hand off of Jodie's right. She's reading it. She's getting hit, and she's finding where she can hit off of the shot.
She's really committing, and that's what she needed to do this round is one thing she kind of hesitated on last round, so I'm glad they're making that adjustment.
Mm-hmm. And DeAnna Bennett has a hard right hand.
And this isn't the stereotypical fight for DeAnna Bennett. We usually see her dirty box up against the fence, really control position, but she's been content to stand at range with Esquibel.
Content, or she's just been unable to close the distance.
True.
You know, it's hard really to say right now. It may have been a strategy she's employing, but it may be that she's falling into the strategy of the other fighter.
Megan, when you're fighting and you get some rounds in, how tactical are you in your own mind, or do you just listen to what your coaches say?
I think it's a bit of both. I'm always listening to my coaches because they're seeing what I'm not seeing. But I also know how the feel of the cage is. I know how my opponent is. You know, you kind of look into their eyes. You can see how they're feeling. And I think I adjust based on that as well.
Right hand to the body for Esquibel. Under 90 seconds remain here in this contest. Been a lot of action. I was hoping to talk to you a little bit more, Megan, but we're trying to keep up with the action of these two fighters. A lot on the line here. Any idea when we might see you back inside the Invicta FC cage now that you're the undisputed featherweight champ?
As soon as they'll have me. I'd love to get back in and fight again, hopefully soon. So, you know, that's up to the team here at Invicta on what they want next for me.
Yeah, how could you ask a fighter when they want to fight again? It's always tomorrow, right?
Yeah.
Maybe later 100%. Tonight. You're watching the athletes play in there right now.
Definitely makes me excited to fight.
Really good exchanges right there from both of them. Both of them took some shots. Jodie Esquibel trying to grab that leg and find an attack off of that.
Yana Bennett kind of stuck out her tongue here. I think she's ready to try to throw down here. Final 30 seconds left in this fight. Left hand by Esquibel.
Both fighters definitely picking up the pace.
Yeah. And go ahead.
And the power. That left hook from Esquibel looked like it kind of stunned her a little bit.
It's been a very even fight. The first round belonged to Deanna Bennett. Left hand there belonged to Jodie Esquibel. Finds the jaw of the Argentine assassin.
Yeah,
10 seconds left.
That tongue coming out there from Bennett, I wonder if she bit her tongue or something. It's not just a gesture, but might be a little bit of a soreness there.
Bennett coming forward, couple of left hands thrown until the final bell. Jodie Esquibel thinks she has it. So does DeAnna Bennett. Nice sign of respect. 15 quality minutes by both of these athletes.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards. Here are the totals. Brett Miller has it 29-28 for Bennett. Fernando Marquez has it 29-28, Esquivel. And Henry Gary scores it 29-28 for your winner by split decision, Jodie Esquivel.
It has been an amazing night already here in Kansas City, and now we see the co-main event of a really great card. Lívia Souza, the former strawweight champion, taking on the reigning atomweight champion, Ayaka Hamasaki. We are ready to go. Strawweights in the cage. Hamasaki coming in with a combination, kick the lead leg there by Souza, right hand for the Brazilian.
Yeah, this is one of those fights where you don't want to blink. They're both going to move very fast.
On Saturday, April 8th, Daniel Cormier and Anthony Johnson will rematch for the UFC Light Heavyweight Championship. UFC 210 live only on pay-per-view at 10 in the East and 7 in the West. Hamasaki from that judo base, as is Souza. Lívia got turned on to jiu-jitsu by watching Hoist Gracie in the early UFC. Actually got the UFC 1 VHS from her local video store. Thought it was an action film. Turned out to be her career. Get at us on Twitter at TJ DeSantis, at Jules K underscore fighter, at Invicta Fights, hashtag Invicta FC 22. We love your comments on Twitter tonight.
We saw a nice right hand land from Souza, but her ducking and covering under the fast punches of Ayaka Hamasaki. Moving backwards and kind of covering up as if she's expecting something.
Right hand nice. To Souza. Hamasaki a bit on the run. Firing back, though, is the Atomweight champ. We saw the evolution of Souza, who came into Invicta, you know, an unknown, undefeated Brazilian with a good jiu-jitsu game.
Oh, big right hand!
Hamasaki might be done! Souza firing away!
Oh, my goodness!
Hamasaki, it is done!
Holy.
Lívia, Renata Souza, shuts up the Scottish right temple!
Oh, my goodness, is she
wow.
out? She's unconscious!
She is unconscious!
Oh.
Lívia, Renata Souza, back in a big way!
Ladies and gentlemen, the end comes at the official time. 1 minute, 41 seconds, round number one. Referee Mike England calls a halt to this bout. Stoppage by strikes, TKO victory for Brazil's own Lívia. Lívia Renata Souza.
Tonya Evinger wants to reclaim that undisputed title.
Here comes some fun, TJ.
It was Evinger that employed a takedown early in the first fight. Now content to exchange of the feet. No,
Tonya,
takedown, right back in
down,
that same position.
Just like she wanted to. Now she's keeping her legs like Kunitskaya is working her way back up. She's got a guillotine with one arm. I don't think she has her hands completely locked right there, but she has a guillotine around Tonya's head. That's not great to do on a wrestler at all times, although it is sunk in a little bit.
She's got that grip. She's. Evinger trying to
oh
maybe punch
goodness.
Out of it. She's got it.
I can't see it.
This is so reminiscent to the first fight, Julia. Quick submission early for the Russian.
It really is. Now, Tonya has her stacked up against, and she's fighting hands, although I can't see the exact angle of it. With that stack, with pushing her against the fence, she can't actually get full extension, Yana Kunitskaya. However, she can get hit, and she can get slammed.
Triple threat three. Kunitskaya now trying for that arm bar.
Working
pivoting
once
off.
Again, just as she did. Trapping the head and the arm of Tonya and then working with her legs and little motions trying to get right back to that armbar on exactly the same arm she hit her with before.
Evinger in a position very familiar. She has that fence there, fighting off the armbar. How dare anyone call Yana Kunitskaya a kickboxer? Knee to the body there, knee planted on the body, now knee on the face.
Now we see Tonya doing exactly what she said she likes to do. She likes to tease that armbar so she can get her guard passed. Now she's in a position, a top position. You can see Yana Kunitskaya looking for that heel hook right there on the fence. Or excuse me, Tanya's on the fence. Yana's looking for the heel hook. Tonya is also grabbing onto the legs, trying to separate. I can't quite see her positioning. I don't think Yana's got that heel hook. Oh, Tanya's going for a toe hold on the opposite side. Beautiful defense against that. The best way to fight leg locks, I think, is either to get up or hit your own leg lock.
This is where Tonya Evinger can take over. Sometimes she fends off submissions to get on top and rain down punishment.
Now, Yana's transition to try and heel hook, inside heel hook the other side.
A hard right hand there gets through by Evinger. Kunitskaya sticking with this footlock.
And Evinger doesn't seem to be showing any franticness to get out of this. She's actually letting herself get a little extended and being very calm right here. Just fighting hands a little bit, but not really showing any pain or any discomfort to have her leg extended like that.
Now she might be switching to a knee bar as Yana Kunitskaya. These leg locks, they're not in until they're in.
They're not. And the problem with leg locks right here is it does get you in a position where you can get cracked.
Now she's really wrenching as Kunitskaya, grimacing on the face, really putting a lot of strength into that. Now Evinger kicking to the body.
Good gracious, she is tenacious with those. Nice liver shot from Tonya Evinger across the body like that. That's gotta be very painful, especially when you're putting so much strain and trying to get that position.
That is a knee bar that is locked in, but the position of a knee bar, sometimes the slightest little bit of space or change of position will not make it work. And thus far, it hasn't worked for Kunitskaya. And now Evinger.
And Evinger has Kunitskaya's arm trapped. It's not in a full arm bar or anything like that, but she's using that to advance position. Kunitskaya, again, just going after those leg locks. Tonya bracing on the head with her knee, trying to get her balance. Bracing on the chest with her knee, trying to get her balance so she can get some shots in. She's in a great top position here. Yana doesn't have anything locked on her now.
What a technical battle we've seen among a slew of technical fights here tonight. Why would it be any different in our main events? Touch over a minute left here. Evinger now punching up some punches from top position. This is Tonya Evinger's
world. Position for Yana Kunitskaya. Really good position to get elbowed from. She's pinned on her back, Tonya, working for that grinding pressure, pushing forward, trying to advance so that she can kind of stretch Kunitskaya out and find positions to punch from or elbow from.
Less than a minute remains here. Interesting round for the judges. Evinger now settling on top here, but it's been Kunitskaya that has been throwing submission attempt after submission attempt. Again, going for that arm bar, not really setting it up, but now immediately on the leg.
Nice hard shot there from Tonya.
Left hands, right hands. Triple threat, turning up the volume. Kunitskaya trying to get her guard back into the arm bar. Tonya Evinger trying to free that left arm.
Oh.
Looks like she's able to get free, but Kunitskaya back in on the leg. Evinger trying to rain down some more punishment. Coming up in the final 10 seconds of this opening round.
Kunitskaya's strategy seems to be grab for an armbar, immediately go for the leg afterwards. That's great pushing, stacking one submission off another, but she does seem to put herself in bad positions to get hit from.
5 minutes in the books. A fight that is shaping up to be signature Yana Kunitskaya and signature.
Still, she was defending leg locks for a little bit. But she also landed a lot of great ground and pound there.
What is interesting about Kunitskaya is she really sells out for all of those submissions, really putting a lot of strength in it. She squeezed that choke for a while. She was really going hard on that knee bar. She's got to watch her strength output to make sure that she doesn't burn herself out. This is a 5-round fight.
Big shot from Tonya there, really off balance Kunitskaya. Now Kunitskaya is trying to get the takedown on the single leg, hitting a little uppercut on the way out.
Hard to take down a world-class wrestler that is Tonya Evinger. Evinger needs to watch her head again. Arm in guillotine attempt for the Russian.
I actually think that almost benefits Evinger in a sense until the arm, unless Yana is able to work around that arm, because Evinger's center of gravity is going to be underneath Kunitskaya. She can pick her up and drop her, or she can trip her off of the fence there. Kunitskaya's arms are kind of almost tied up right there. She's got to get good position. She's got to push off that center. Oh, beautiful.
Nicely done by Kunitskaya, able to break the posture there of Evinger. But Evinger, again, an elite level wrestler. You may be able to trip her up for a second, but securing the position is what is going to be most important and honestly the most difficult.
And in cases like you're seeing, the fence is actually acting as a third fighter in the cage almost. They're able to balance off of it, and throws that may actually take them down or not taking them down. Now Kunitskaya is pushing on the head of Evinger, which is actually preventing her from getting a total lock on her and takedown position. She's trying to get those little knees in. Unfortunately, Evinger is cognizant of that. She's pushing out against those knees, and she's looking for opportunities to grab the leg to take her down.
Evinger trying to scoop the legs out from underneath the Russian. Now she gets her seated.
And again, Kunitskaya is trying for that guillotine. Evinger's head is in there. I think her neck is locked, but it doesn't look like it's troubling her that much.
She's in a half guard here. This is where Evinger is usually able to set up shop and rain down that signature style of ground and pound.
And something we've learned from actually Lorosenko when she's trained with Evinger before is that Evinger is very good at moving her feet at the same time she's doing something with her arms. So she's punching, but she's also making little adjustments with her feet and her hips the entire time. Her body stays in motion.
Now this is where Tonya Evinger wants to be cleared from the full guard, not in any trouble, but it's Kunitskaya that's trying to get a guard established once again.
And Kunitskaya is grabbing onto that leg with her own legs, trying to keep Tonya from being completely mounted on her, also locking her arms around in the hopes that she can kind of shift her when her weight changes and push her over. It's very hard to shift Tonya Evinger's weight when she wants to be on you, and she has some world-class wrestling.
Past the halfway point of round number two, Kunitskaya able to get back to a closed guard.
And this is what she did well in the first fight. You know, she was taken down into side control, and she was able to re-guard and establish that armbar.
Now, if you're Tonya Evinger settling in the guard here, what do you need to do to make sure you don't get caught with that armbar? Where does she need to leave her arm?
Her right arm is on the ground. It needs to not be on the ground right now. She's very confident with it, but it's more easily trapped if you base your hands on the ground. They're much easier to trap from the bottom guy.
Kunitskaya throwing some elbows from her back, attacking the shoulders of Evinger.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that's just kind of a work for motion right there. There may be some nerve endings and stuff you can hit, but it doesn't, in my mind, do quite as much damage as, say, a big cut from an elbow. And she's kind of doing her, doing her filthy movement, pushing on the face, pushing on the mouth like she likes to do. It's also a great way to establish an elbow if you base like that. Kunitskaya again climbing up, trying for an armbar position. She's really all about those elbows.
Evinger now sets up inside. Nice pass for herself. Now this is where some opponents sort of wilt from that pressure of Evinger. Now putting the face,
the knee
on the face.
Yeah. You know,
Evinger talked about how she was going to drag this one out. She wanted to punish Kunitskaya a little bit.
And I sometimes think if maybe you smell blood, you decide not to do that midway through. If you know, like, she's gotten to her back now. She's in a pretty good position. Yana Kunitskaya is still fighting, but Evinger's arm is wrapped around her neck. So she's got a rear naked choke locked on. I'm not sure how tight it is just yet.
Hard to see, no figure four grip right away here. Kunitskaya worried. Tonya Evinger now has a figure four.
Oh, it's under the neck, DJ.
It is done. Tonya Evinger remains the Invicta FC Bantamweight Champion.
Ladies and gentlemen, the end comes the official time, 4 minutes, 32 seconds, round number two, submission by rear naked choke for your winner, and still, Invicta FC Bantamweight Champion of the World, Triple Threat.